Everyone who's here, people online, Lord, I pray that this word encourages us, empowers us, Lord. Well, I don't just want it to be inspirational. I want it to be transformational. I want it to transform us,
yes, Lord,
God,
yes,
through
Lord.
Your word and through your spirit,
yes,
Lord.
Father.
Inspiration and emotion only last for a little time, but your spirit and empowerment will get us through a lifetime.
Thank you.
And we thank you. In your name, amen. May be seated, please. This is Luke 1, verses 46 through 56. Mary, this is after Elizabeth prays over her. Mary responded, "Oh, how my soul praises the Lord! How my spirit rejoices in God my Savior! For he took notice of his lowly servant girl. And from now on, all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One is holy, and he has done great things for me. He shows mercy from generation to generation to all who fear him." That's that reverence part. Not fear like I'm afraid, but fear not to have in our lives. "His mighty arm has done tremendous things. He has scattered the proud and haughty ones. He has brought down princes from their thrones and exalted the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away with empty hands. He has helped his servant Israel and remembered to be merciful. For he made this promise to our ancestors, to Abraham and his children forever." Mary stayed with Elizabeth about 3 more months, then went back to her home. So what is Mary seeing here? What is Mary saying here? First of all, she's thanking God. And notice how she refers to herself as a lowly person. Because literally, that was the mindset. Okay, women weren't what they are right now. Now, I take that back. No. Women didn't think about and act like sometimes they do now. We have this encouragement, come on, ladies, you got this, bro. You're empowered, you can do this, and so on and so forth. It was like, be a mom, be a parent maybe, be a servant girl, help out, do that, help the man, so on and so forth. So she refers to herself as somebody lonely, not in like a negative way, but that was the mindset and position, okay? And now she's saying all the good things God did before, like Old Testament perspective, and she knows she's carrying Jesus. And she's saying, here's the Savior, the angel told her. You're going to be birthed to the Savior of the world. So she's carrying salvation. Hey, check this out. So away.
That's good.
And no man, you can't get pregnant, but you're still carrying salvation. That was a nice little swing there, wasn't it? And the Lord is using, listen, 2 mighty women of faith. Okay? Right? Well, I was just as the hashtag boy mom, right? But these are 2 young boys, listen, that are going to change the world. John the Baptist first, because he's the one who goes out and proclaims to repent and get baptized. And this is going to let you know right now, he's saying, there's someone coming. Woo, you don't even know. You don't even know. That's how we should be with people. Man, there's someone that can save you. You don't even know. You don't even know. Because he's done it for me. And these 2 babies, these 2 boys are going to change the world. And obviously, Jesus, he's changing the world for thousands of years and for thousands to come, unless he comes back before that. At the rate of this world, he might not be coming back for a long time. As soon as the war broke out in Palestine and Israel, all the prophets are online. 1 more week left. I was like, I hope they're right. I know these knuckleheads are wrong. It's nice to stop dealing with all this junk down here. But these two babies, these 2 baby boys, these 2 women, these 2 mighty women of God are part of a transformation that's going to happen not only worldwide at the time, okay, but for thousands of years and for decades to come. And listen, women were a significant part of the life of Jesus. Mm-hmm. You know, and again, I shared before, and I'll tell you this, but let me get this too from a cultural perspective. Never mind if you were just a man and how you looked at a woman, okay? But if you were a rabbi, which Jesus was considered, okay, this is rabbinical teachings and laws. He's considered a rabbi, a teacher. He's obviously the Lord. But if you were a rabbi, you would have even less to do with any woman. It would be like some other person you tell, and they wouldn't even speak to a woman. It was considered like just, you know, not a cultural thing. And he's breaking every rule, and I love it. I love it. Okay, because if it was non-existent that a rabbi would even touch or encounter, especially a woman who wasn't a Jewish woman, Okay? And again, this is a cultural thing. Listen, to this day, the Middle East is the same way. Women are like considered, like, why do you think these women try to leave there, come here, mix up with their lives? Because over there, they're treated like you know, I don't want to say animals, but like they're not treated properly, human-like, you know? And Jesus knew the significance of women and how they were going to play a major part, listen, in his redemption plan. First, through the two moms. Okay? Listen, God didn't just send Jesus to the earth without having a birth, but there was a plan there. Right? John the Baptist could have just been someone that showed up. Okay, but no, there was a plan there. And it's funny because, you know, the first message, preaching, we hear Peter, the apostle. He's the one who speaks it. And he says something that, again, it's something that's, he's quoting a prophet of the Old Testament, Joel, but he shares some stuff which is like, not the norm, how people would look. And listen to these verses. This is Acts 2, 16 through 18. Listen. This is Peter's first message. And 3,000 people get saved after he's done preaching. Okay? And they get water baptized. But listen. Now, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last day, God says, I'll pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. So Peter's given us an example already because he walked with Jesus, and he saw what Jesus did with women, how he encountered women. When Mary poured oil over Jesus in the house, the religious leaders said, look at him, he touches a sinner. That was the mindset. But everywhere in the gospel, every encounter almost that Jesus has, not all, but quite a few of them, are with women. The woman at the well, Samaritan woman, who was hated by Jews. So never mind just being Jewish on his own, but he's a rabbi and a teacher. He should be nowhere near this woman. And what's he doing? He's kicking it with, hey, how you doing? What's going on? Hey, can I, a little thirsty. Do you mind getting me a cup of water? And we're going to read some of the story later. The woman caught in adultery. He would have nothing to do with a sinful woman. But he encounters her.
Praise God.
We're going to read a little about that too. The woman in Nain, a little region there, that she was a widow and her son died. And there was the only person that could provide for him. Most women didn't even work because the father or the son or a male that was in the family would work and provide for them. That's why Jesus said, take care of the widow and the orphan. The scriptures tell us that. Because they would have no one to provide. And what does Jesus do? He's talking to her, and you know what? He had compassion. He raises his son out of the coffin from the dead. The woman with the issue of blood. Right? She's sick for a decade and a half. That's in the Gospel of Luke. A Gentile woman. Okay, there's so many stories. But the Gentile woman, who again, somebody that a Jewish person wouldn't even be dealing with. Never mind a rabbi. And he has compassion. And he actually says that he hasn't seen any other faith like this lady has. He loves women. He loved women. He loved men. He loved children. He loved everybody. And I'll say he loves everybody. He had compassion. And he knew how important the role that women would play in ministry. That's why I came up with the mighty women of More. These women were mighty women of More. And I know there's women in this church that are mighty women of More, that love the Lord and live for the Lord. Maybe someone online is watching today. You can be a mighty woman of More. Maybe you're questioning or someone else that's listening. You can be a mighty woman of More. So listen, this is after Jesus went to the cross. Okay, he's beaten and crucified. This is Matthew 27:55. Many women were there watching from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee to care for his needs. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Joseph, and the mothers of Zebedee's sons. Even after the Lord was buried, who's the first people to go find out that he raised from the dead? It wasn't Peter and them. You're walking with this guy. He's doing miracles for 3 years. And you're hiding in your house because you're afraid of things. And the women go. And they're the ones who find out that Jesus is alive. He rose from the grave. Okay? And they were also going there. You know, there was a ceremonial thing that you did. You took these cloths and you put them in spices and you wrapped them over the body. Luke 24:1. Listen, on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They're the ones that show up. And I'll tell you the mindset of how they looked at women. When the women went and told them, they didn't even believe them. Mm-hmm. Be careful. Women play an equal role, an important role in the things of God. And if you want to get technical, okay, more women go to church than men in the United States. Actually, I take that back. More women go to church than men in the whole world, for the most part. Definitely in Latin America and South America. You go to church, it's like 65% women. Women play a key role. Why do you think I'm always trying to smack men aside of the head spiritually? Trying to get them to take their stand, take their position, own it. Well, let me get started on that. You know all this men stuff. I know that stuff in my brain. We're going to look at five keys, listen, that we learn from some of these women. And again, the principles are for everybody. Okay? Here's the first one. Mighty women of more meet the needs of others. We read in Matthew 27:55 how the woman came from Galilee. They followed Jesus and they cared for him. Okay? And as we read earlier, right, that how he encountered women and there was situations that he had with them. Okay? Women supported him. Listen, they even gave their resources to him. Listen, Luke 8:1-3. Soon afterwards, Jesus began a tour of the nearby towns and villages, preaching and announcing the good news about the kingdom of God. He took his 12 disciples with him, along with some women. And listen to the word. He took with him. Not that they followed. He invited them. We're not taking somebody with me somewhere. You know, like a men's breakfast. I have like 45 or 100. But listen, like, you know what I'm trying to say? You know what I'm trying to say? Anyway, listen. He was like, oh, come on. Hey, guys. Let's go. Almost. He took his 12 disciples along with some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases. Among them were Mary Magdalene, from whom he had cast out 7 demons, Joanna, the wife of Chuza, Herod's business manager, Susanna, and many others were contributing from their own what? Resources to support Jesus and his disciples. And check out the women. It doesn't say he took a bunch of religious leaders' wives with him. You know, he's pure. He took a bunch of sinful women. He took a bunch of, like, women that everybody else said, nah. And he was like, yeah.
Come on.
Women, don't ever believe. Ladies.
That's right. That's right.
Don't ever believe. Don't ever. Don't let society.
Come on.
Don't let maybe somebody speaking negatively over you.
Jesus.
The devil whispering in your ear some lies, and you ain't this, and you ain't that. Mm-hmm. Or maybe even some of the stuff you see on Facebook, or just social media in general, making you think you're less. You want to get some book and get some information, look in his book and see what he thinks about you.
Amen. That's right.
The apple of his eye.
Amen.
That you're more than a conqueror.
Amen.
That I think about you more than all the grains of sand on the seashore.
So much.
It says. Okay? It says you're victorious in Christ. I'll never leave you or forsake you.
Thank you, Lord.
Women play a mighty role.
Yeah.
A mighty role in Jesus' ministry, and they should in general. Godly women, called, blessed by God, used by the Lord. Listen, right in the beginning, Genesis 2:18. And when it is the second chapter of the Bible, 18 verses in. Now, they created man already, okay? Man's already there doing his thing. Now, I don't know if this part's true, but it's something that I thought. And man, anyone who's, I don't know if everyone's married, who's listening to that. Anyone who's married and your wife leaves for a little while, you know you need her then.
Amen.
Because you're like, you're buying food, you're getting delivered, you're getting a good cooked meal. This is some stuff I'm getting clean, because you ain't cleaning it. Like, oh, they're being like, I'm not trying to say women are cooking clean. Take it easy.
Pastor, he's a joke, isn't
he? No, but like you. So I'm thinking about, God said, listen, the Lord God said, Amen. So I was like thinking about some of the brothers who can't handle being alone. I know some guys, they're lost without their spouses or their significant other. You know? And honestly, I was just thinking like, man, God knew we needed help. Some of you were like, preach, Pastor, they need help today too. Listen to Proverbs 31:26. She opens her mouth in wisdom, and the teachings of kindness are on her tongue.
That's right.
Women are mighty warriors.
That's right.
Pastor Frank, every month has a prayer. The church I was at yesterday speaking. He has a prayer thing every once a month. And he called his men out yesterday. I was like, man, bro, why'd you call him out before I was preaching? You messed them all up. But he was just like, yeah, there was 12 women there and no men. Women are prayer warriors too. Mm-hmm. Maybe God and Jesus do something that we need to find out. Right? Here's the second thing. Mighty women of more know the power of Jesus. Listen, I mentioned before the woman with the issue of bleeding with blood. Listen to the story. Listen. Matthew 9:20-22. Just then a woman who had been subject for bleeding for 12 years came up behind him and touched the hedge of his cloak. She said to herself, if I only touch his cloak, I'll be healed. Jesus turned and saw her. Take heart, daughter, he said. Your faith has healed you. And that woman was healed at that moment. But there's something Luke writes that's not in Matthew. Listen to what Luke writes. In Luke 8:46, same woman, same story. She touches him. But Jesus said, someone touched me. I know that power has gone out from me. Know what he's saying, ladies? Just touch him.
Yeah, reach
and
out.
And get some power.
Come on.
Just touch him. And you'll get some power. And I love that he knew. If you read the story, Jesus goes, someone touched me. And I felt the power come out. And they're saying this in Luke. And they go, Lord, there's like 1,000 people like crowding around you, trying to get something from you. A healing touch. How did you know? He's going, no, old man. Come on.
Come on.
Listen. Preach. Man, this is
Jesus.
You know why he knew she touched her? Because she had faith.
Yeah.
She said, man, I've been to doctors. You read the story. She's been to doctors. She spends every dollar she has trying to get healed. For 12 years, we read, right? But she finds out about Jesus. Someone thought, hey, this is Jewish dude. People think he's nuts. Ooh, he's going around. He's touching caskets. Sons are being raised from the dead. He's opening blind eyes from blind people. He turns some water into wine. He's healing people. People are coming. People are preaching. There's all kinds of stuff. I bet you if you touch him, you'll get healed.
Mine.
And this girl probably said, where is this dude? Mm.
Come on. Preach.
Historically, you don't know the numbers. But if you go by the regions, okay, you all know, I love the Bible and history of it. There had to be 500, 600 people around him. You know what else this lady did? She fought her way to Jesus.
Yes.
It wasn't, this is a woman now, okay? There's probably men around there. And she's a sick woman. You know what they thought in those days? They thought you were cursed. So if you were sick and you had a disease or something like that, you were considered cursed. This girl's like, I don't care what you think. I'm getting healed. Mm.
That's right. Come
and
on.
She fought through somebody.
Yes.
She didn't get shattered.
Yes.
That's the kind of faith.
That's big faith.
That's the kind of faith. And yes. He knew he had to know that this woman had so much faith. I felt her healing. Because it wasn't like he encountered her. She encountered him. Ladies, encounter him.
Amen.
Encounter him.
Yes.
Encounter him. And keep trusting him. Keep trusting. Valentina gave me the little card, Proverbs 3:5. Trust the Lord with all your heart. Listen to me. Don't lean on your own understanding of something. Okay? Scriptures tell us most of the time the opposite of what we're thinking. We think no, God says yes. We think it can't, God says it can. We think happy, God says, because I'll make a way.
That's right. Come on.
Because the world's trying to lie, the devil's trying to lie, so we're probably lying to ourselves too.
Yeah.
Here's the third thing. Mighty woman of God, stay close to Jesus. I love this story. And I'm telling you, man, I used to be a Martha. Not literally, take a moment. I'm the furthest from a Martha there ever is. But like the mindset that she had, okay? So Martha and Mary and Lazarus are friends of Jesus, close friends. Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. Remember, it was the, they said the prayer, come, and so on. So they go there, and Martha's busy trying to serve, and Mary's going, man, I need to just sit at the king's feet and get a little something. Listen, Luke 10:38-39. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, they came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home up to him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. We keep reading the story. Martha's cooking, trying to, you know, there's people in their house, you know, she's entertaining, whatever. And Mary's just sitting there. And normally, you know, she's like, Mary, give me a hand. Mary's like, are you kidding? Jesus is here. Jesus, he'll make some food, okay? He'll do what we're eating if he has to, but he's over here talking to us, encouraging us. I'm spending time with him right now. Ladies, spend time with Jesus. Amen. Men, spend time with Jesus.
Amen.
And don't let a little dad do it. Don't let a quick little four-minute devotion
right,
do
right.
it. Spend
Come
some
on.
Time with Jesus.
Yes.
And here's the bottom line, ready? It'll be the best time you spend all day. I don't care who you meet.
That's right.
I don't care who you're going to meet that day.
That's right.
I don't care if you're going to meet your favorite movie star. I don't care. What, you and your husband going on a coffee date. You and your kids doing something. I don't care. Your work's helping you go on a trip. You're going to go on a work trip to, I don't know, down the shore. You ain't meeting nobody that day better than Jesus.
Amen.
You're not meeting anyone. We're not meeting anyone that day that we can spend time with. That's going to be better than spending time with Jesus. It ain't me, is it? You got someone better?
No.
Because there is none. That's why.
That's right.
There is none. There is none. Listen, Psalms 27:8. My heart has heard you say, come and talk with me. Come on, listen. This is David talking. And God saying, come and talk with me. And my heart responds, Lord, I'm coming.
Yes, yes.
Come on, Lord, I'm coming.
Yes, Lord.
Don't let Facebook draw you away in the morning. Don't check your post to see. Listen, sit with Jesus and say, Lord, I'm coming to talk to you. Lord, I'm coming. Here's number four, we're almost done. Mighty woman of Nain received forgiveness from Jesus. Remember the story we just touched on, a woman caught in adultery, okay? So the law was that if you were caught in adultery, they could stone you to death. Like literally stone you to death. So Jesus is teaching in the courtyard, and they sort of like want to like put him up to the task. So they drag this woman, and maybe the woman that was her husband, whoever it was, they drag her into this courtyard, and they're screaming and yelling, she's an adulterer! They're going crazy, and Jesus is coming, and now they go, Rabbi, what should we do? And they're testing him. And he goes, well, listen. If any of you have not sinned, be the first one to cast the stone. And they had already had their stones in their hand because they're thinking they're going to stone this woman.
Mm-hmm.
So as they were dragging her down the street, whatever it was, they're picking up rocks and stuff. And actually, in some areas, they would have a pile of stones already waiting. And they would take a person and put them there, people would pick up their stones. So Jesus goes, whoever has never sinned, be the first one to cast the stone. And the story says they trumped them one by one. It's very interesting too. I can't go through the whole thing, right? But it's funny because in one of the stories, or one of the areas of the Gospels, it says that they dropped them one by one from the oldest to the youngest. And I always thought, the older we get, the worse we sin. Because we've been sinning for so long. Not the actual sin, the quantity of sin, but our lives, our lifetime. And I feel like that's an insight. Right, little 5-year-old kids pure and they're not, right? Someone who's 50, you've been around 5 decades, and there's a lot of junk in the trunk. But he goes, whoever hasn't sinned, and the funniest part of this is that The only person who could have threw a stone was him.
That's right.
Because he's the only one who was sinless.
That's right.
But what does he do? John 8:10-11. Then Jesus stood up again and said to the woman, "Where are your accusers? Didn't even one of them condemn you?" "No, Lord," she said. And Jesus said, "Neither do I. Go and sin no more." Listen, there is nothing we'll ever do that we're not forgiven of already.
Amen.
But that doesn't give us a license
That's right.
to keep doing it.
That's right.
That should give us the power to know not to do it.
Yes.
Psalms 86:5. "Oh Lord, you are so good, so ready to forgive, so full of unfailing love for all you who ask for all who ask for your help." He's a good God. He loves
Amen.
Us.
Amen.
Ladies, don't ever let the lies of this world, the shortcomings we have, make you get into a position that you're not that's not of God. And sometimes we can get dragged down to a dark place. You know, because of the junk we go through, or how we do things sometimes, or how we mess up maybe sometimes. When we're saved and we're filled with the Holy Spirit, all God sees is Jesus over us. Mm-hmm. As his protector, as his covering. Here's the last point. I think it's 5, yes. "Mighty woman of more, tell others about Jesus." Okay, I shared the story before. The Samaritan woman at the well. Listen, Samaritans and Jews hated each other. Hated. So let's read. John 4:27-29. "Just then his disciples came back. They were shocked to find him talking to the woman. But none of them had the nerve to ask." Just look at this. They were shocked that he's talking to her. Shocked, like, what is he doing? First of all, never mind talking to a woman. You're talking to a Samaritan woman? Now, this woman had 5 husbands. She was living with a man she wasn't married to. Jesus called her out, but Jesus loved on her. "Talking to a woman, but none of them had nerve to ask, 'What do you want with her? Or why are you talking to her?' The woman left her water jar beside the well and ran back to the village, telling everyone, 'Come and see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could he possibly be the Messiah?'" Could he possibly be the Messiah? Listen, there's nothing we can hide from God.
That's right.
And he loves us anyway.
Yep.
And that's why he told this woman all her stuff. He was just trying to let her know that, "Hey girl, I know you're a sinner, but guess what? I've come to save you. I've come to save you." He's come to save us and forgive us and empower us and love us. And you know what this lady does? She goes back and tells everybody about it. Now all these people want to know about this Jesus. Listen, John 4:39. "Many Samaritans from the village believed in Jesus because the woman had said, 'He told me everything I ever did.'" That's our job, ladies and gentlemen. Go and tell others. Pastor Lane's famous line, just share your testimony. "I used to be jacked up and now I'm not."
Amen.
"I still got issues, but I got
yes.
Jesus.
Oh, yes.
I'm saved. I'm loved. I'm
oh, yes.
forgiven.
Yes.
I'm blessed.
Yes,
I'm empowered. I'm mature. I'm better than I used to be. I may not be who I want to be yet, but I'm on my way."
Come on.
And remember where she goes. Okay? You got to understand this. She goes to the village of all Samaritans. And she's like, "Hey, I met this Jewish guy." They're like, "Get out of here. You ain't messing with no Jews. We hate them." And let me tell you about this one. This one came to save us. This is God's love 101. All this stuff. Ladies, know who you are in Christ. Know who you are. Don't ever let the things of this world, your own personal issues you've got going on, maybe when someone else thinks about you. I share this many times. I remember the first time I read in Genesis, and Moses, and said, God was telling Moses, you know, "Fear me, not man." And I was like, that's easy, because I don't fear man anyway. But God, I fear you. Listen, this day and age, ladies, it's hard. I was thinking about this when I wrote this, and I'm going to pray in a minute. And I was just like, man, like this world tells women Okay, like in order to be strong, be more like a man actually. Like when you read, you know, be strong, climb the corporate ladder, be there, I'm independent, I'll bring the garbage out, I'll do that, I'll go along, I'll change you up. Nothing wrong with anybody doing that, okay, FYI. Okay? But like sometimes in order to be a strong woman, you gotta start doing some masculine things. Like if you read on this and it's and I'm like, no. Strong women just love God. Strong women just serve God. The same way strong men do. It's the same. And that's why society gets twisted. That's why people start leading, I think I'm this, because really I'm not even a... But you get close to God, you'll never think anything except you're a godly person. A godly woman who's loved by the Lord. Who he looks down upon you and he empowers you to be all you are. I wrote this, ladies, stay blessed, be the best, keep passing the test, and with God, you'll always stay ahead of the rest. Ladies, be blessed, be the best, keep passing the test, and with God, you'll always stay ahead of the rest. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for today, Lord. Lord, thank you for all the moms getting celebrated. Thank you for the ladies being celebrated today, Lord, through your word, through your spirit, Lord. Rise up within our hearts and in our minds. Just give us a rest of an amazing day. Let us reflect back on this and keep being all that you call us to be. And we love you. In your name, amen.
Amen.